Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And also good morning to all of you. So we have about 45 minutes now, so I'll present quickly about 30 minutes, and then we can have some Q&A, right? So this is the first solution I'm suggesting. I left the university after being here a total of almost 30 years. I was in this university for 30 years, so I know every corner. So one of the things I'm doing is called this IGENS. I'm at the consulting group. It's an electronic payment system to basically what I believe can solve a lot of the problems, monetary problems that we are talking about. So I try to explain, and then later you can question me or to think that whether it can be really a solution to me. But after teaching the course of monetary and payment systems for a long time, I really think this is a very good solution. I call it IGENS. It's interest-free goal-based electronic netting system. So gold here I'm using because it's the major commodity that has always played the role of money. But I'll later tell you, I'll show you that actually it can be any commodity that fulfills the criteria of money. Eh? But gold will always dominate. So therefore we will use interest-free. So you see there are a few characteristics. First is interest-free. It is goal-based, it's electronic, it's netting. So the four characteristics there. So I don't want to go through all, most of my talks, we always say always talk about problems, right? So today I'm going to skip all those problems quickly, and then we go and discuss the solution. Yeah. So the next slide. Next slide, please. So you see, if you like to see the problem, I've already linked interest-based to fiat money. The fiat money system has implications for economy, for society, for politics and environment. So if you have, I have no time to go through all this, but if you have, if you are interested, you can go to my blog. You see how we link the monetary system to inflation, like what Zahid was telling you about. How it affects the disparity in income distribution and wealth distribution, the Gini coefficients, right? And also how it actually creates poverty. So yeah, you can read that. How it creates business cycles and also responsible for recession and so forth. And also that brings about unemployment. So unemployment is a characteristic of the fiat monetary system. Yeah. So if you go into history and you look into the Roman Empire, what was the unemployment rate in Roman Empire? Can anyone tell you? It was never recorded in history because it never happened, okay? So you go to countries, societies, even in this part of the world, the Sri Vijaya, like the Hindu kingdom, ruled for more than 2,000 years. Has any historian recorded what was the unemployment rate? Because it has never happened, right? Because those people, they all were using real money in the system. So you will see that once the system creates, what it creates is that when the disparity of income happens, they step on to this thing, the poor will first suffer, then the middle income group will collapse, everyone collapse, you will create huge, very wealthy people at the top. Then finally, the huge wealthy people will fight among themselves. This is what is happening globally. They have already destroyed everything, the big ones now fighting among right at the top, okay? So you will create conflicts and wars. So we are not getting ready for real conflicts or wars that are going to happen globally. Because we have messed up the big time the global monetary system. And it also has a lot of implications for the economy, especially the destruction of ecosystems and climate change. Particularly because of the interest portion is not payable in real terms. In other words, the interest that we charge in the monetary system does not exist in the real form. Because it's not real, so in macroeconomics, then you can only pay the interest in the form of real things. So if you have a nice forest in the country, and then you borrow from IMF, World Bank, at interest, you will tend to cut down deforestation, cut down the trees faster at the moment interest rate goes up, so that you can pay the interest portion. You see, that's why these nations, the institutions, international institutions, when they give loans, they like to give countries that have resources like this. You have oil, you have forest, you have this thing. So ultimately, you will see all of this disappearing out of nothing. So they create climate change and everything. And then recently I also gave a talk why it also causes the shrinking of population. You look at Japan, it's decreasing the population. Look at the entire Europe, it's decreasing. Look at Singapore. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, in his last book, he wrote the number one problem for Singapore is the shrinking population, is it? So when you look at why all this is happening, you see because the interest based on the system. So long you don't correct that, we will face this. It is by structure, it is scientifically it's linked all this. So if you like to read, you go ahead. I don't want to spend time on this, so let's go to the next. I want to speak more on the solution. So let's go to the next slide, please. Next slide. Okay, so if you see some of the serious global issues currently is the serious inflation. We in Malaysia feel that, but not only in Malaysia actually. If you go to any country, you'll see that. Because there's a huge fiat monetary system, which is a bubble, that is actually collapsing. Trillions, more than $1,200 trillion of a bubble that is now from just in the air, like a cloud in the derivatives market, it is coming down, trickling down to the real economy. Alright, so you go to any country, the first is the price of your real estate will go up, price of your buildings will go up, and after that the price of your food and everything will continuously go up. So don't think the inflation you're facing is just finished, it's continue. So the widening gap in the income and wealth distribution that is very clearly documented in the recent Oxfam report, the wealthiest 62 people now own as much as half the world's population. Just 62 people own about 3.5 billion people's wealth, listen, only. Just a couple of years ago, it was about 300 something, just, you know. So now it's only 62. Next year, you'll find only about 30 people. Then next, about 15 people is there, you know? Because it will accumulate wealth with the wealthy. Tremendously creating a distribution gap. And then we also know that environmental degradation and unsustainability, global warming is on. So the world is, they finally realize whatever we are doing is unsustainable. So that's why everybody now doing conferences on unsustainable. Huh? The United Nations is talking about unsustainable and issues and so on. Next slide, please. So if you can see, one of the things in the United Nations is now they're talking about inclusive wealth index. So you can download the report, inclusive wealth report. It looks into basically on sustainability issues. Now there's a new way of measuring wealth. They don't look only at the GDP. GDP is just the wealth of whatever goods and services we produce. Now they recognize nature is also wealth. So in the previous computation, when we have a tree in the jungle, it's not wealth until you cut down. When you cut down, it becomes timber, or then it goes into GDP calculation. But now, no. The moment you have a tree, it is a natural wealth. You cut down, the natural wealth goes down. If you build a dam in that place, then the produced wealth goes up. And there's a cost-benefit analysis. Destruction, natural wealth goes down, produced wealth goes up. Is there a justification or not like that? And it's now different. A very complex mathematical models are involved. Next slide, please. So the objective of this thing is, I'm going to argue with you why an interest-free gold-based electronic banking system can solve almost all the problems I mentioned earlier. All of them. Why a system like this can help? So injecting, why? It's an effective way of injecting first liquidity into the economy. It is practically free. It can spur business and employment while promoting economic justice and bringing about structural stability, inflation-free, both economic and environmental sustainability. Sounds funny, isn't it? That you can show you why you can contribute like that. So the Islamic side of it, when you want to listen netting, is Mukassa. So Mukassa is, if you are a PhD student, I would encourage you to go and look into this. It's a very interesting way of doing things. Because if you see all kinds of structures we have seen, isn't it? In Islamic finance, but rarely people talk about Mukassa or netting as this thing. So far, because I have written one paper on how to use Mukassa for designing an Islamic credit card. That you can find on if you Google, you can get how do we use Mukassa to design a credit card system. But other than that, this is another thing. So this is what I would like to show you, why this Mukassa or netting system can be a very sophisticated way of solving the problem. There are a few things I'm going to show you. First, it will increase liquidity into the economy. And that will increase profitability. And normally when it increases profitability, it will also increase tax for the government. So the government should be also happy if you introduce this, alright? Then it will introduce economic justice. It's inflation-free. Interesting, it's inflation-free and economic stability and sustainability, alright? Next slide. Let me just highlight you what's liquidity, alright? Security is, for example, you see, all of us, we have different skills. That's how God has created us. You know how to do something else, I don't know how to do something else, another. Then we produce the thing and then we exchange. The exchanging is what is profit in economics. So if you are an accountant, you produce, let's say, cars. The car will only go into the inventory. It's not, the moment you produce a car, it's not profit for you yet. In your accounting, it is only an inventory. The moment you exchange your car with somebody else, okay, now I sell the car to you and I take the code from somebody else. I don't know how to make code, but I know how to make car, right? So the moment I take the code, it will go as a profit for me and also for a profit for the one who's selling the code. So you notice that profit is an increase in utility when exchange takes place. Right? Profitability is the measure of the utility increase due to exchange. So because we have different skills, and then there are barter problem in exchange, so we introduce money to solve the problem of barter. So let's say these people are all the faces, people in the economy, and this is money in circulation. So money is solving the problem, so you are exchanging, right? You are able to exchange goods and services. So that's why with the money, you notice that you own almost 100% of the things we own. The spectacle I wear, the watch I wear, the shirt I wear, the shoes I wear, the car I drove here, none of them I know how to make. Is there anything, almost 100% of the thing that you own, you do not know how to make them. It is because made by other people with other people's knowledge. So that's why it's always beneficial to educate other people. Right? Okay? So what happens is that will increase, when the money changes, it increases the well-being of the people. But historically, let's say in the earlier slide, the money was, let's say, gold and silver in like the historical listing. So periodically in history, people have made demonetization of silver, like what happened in 1873. It happened in Europe, it also happened in America. So when they demonetize silver, so for most people they use silver as money, only the rich people have gold. Right? Gold also is the main thing. But most of the market transactions are in silver coin. Including even our name ringgit, our Malaysian ringgit is actually the name of a Spanish silver coin. So let's say when they made a demonetization of silver, suddenly people who had silver is no longer money. Only people who had gold is now money. So when you reduce the amount of money in circulation, the economy will immediately go into a recession. Not because people do not want to work, not because people have no needs to be fulfilled, it's simply because you stop the liquidity or reduce the liquidity in the economy. You reduce the transactions that can take place between people. So most recessions happen when that happens, when amount of money in circulation decreases in the economy. So that's the reason why you would notice when any time recession happens, the governments, the central bank always takes expansionary monetary policies. They print new money, they call it quantitative easing. It's actually printing money, but it sounds like quantum physics, isn't it? Quantitative easing, right? It's actually just printing money. In Malaysia, when in 1998, when the crisis happened, we reduced the reserve requirement, the fractional reserve requirement, which Brother Zahid was trying to tell. IMF tried to make us increase the interest rate, because if you increase interest rate, the amount of money will also grow faster. See, but you increase the interest rate, but you also destroy many other people who have taken loans. So that's why Mahathir at that time, he refused to follow IMF. But you reduce the reserve requirement from 13% to 4%, remember, right? So similarly, so when the recession goes down, it happens, but you, especially monetary policies is done to increase back the money, liquidity. So this is the problem. Liquidity is, a lot of time economy faces problem because lack of money in circulation or problem with liquidity, right? Next slide. So netting involves what I call information money. So there are two kinds of money. When you have the notes, dollar notes, this is what we call physical money, right? But now we have electronic money, even though it's virtual, it's something like physical because in our mind there is something there. So you can transfer to your account, I can transfer to this thing. It's still something like money, right? But netting involves what we call information as money. This is the most fantastic thing in this thing. It uses information. And that is where we are now moving, the fintech. We find today everyone is using a mobile phone as money. It's meant to be e-wallet. Whatever solution we give within the e-wallet kind of thing, right? So therefore, information technology is going to change tremendously the playing field. Bankers, if they ignore this fintech, they will be obsolete in no time. So information technology, we will do this, information money. Yeah? So I'll give you an example. I'll give everything 1,000. For example, in Charlie here, he supplies vegetable to a hotel. Let's say he supplies 1,000 ringgit vegetable on credit. And Mr. Chong here, he has sent to his son to school and he needs to pay his son's tuition fee 1,000. The school, it organized a seminar in the hotel and it owes the hotel 1,000. And Mr. Chong, he renovated Mr. Abu's office, he's a contractor. So he, so Mr. Abu owes Mr. Chong 1,000. I make everything 1,000 first lah. And then Mr. Abu here, he repaired Mr. Ali, who is a farmer, Ali's tractor, also 1,000. So if you look at the balance sheet, so there will be a debtor creditor all existing in everybody's balance sheet because they're all on credit. So there will be debtor creditor, all 1,000. When you look at the balance sheet, they will be appearing there, all of them. So in a simple diagram, something like this. For each one of them, there are five units here. The school, the chari, the hotel, and then here is the school, hotel. So this hotel is the school, okay? And this is Mr. Chok, and then this is Mr. Bukhi. So each one of them over 1,000. So all of them appearing in their balance sheet. Alright? Now let's say all of them are owing 1,000. Let's say somebody, Mr. Aziz here, he comes to the hotel. He pays 1,000 as a deposit just to stay or to use the hotel facilities. After you use, then let's say you didn't use some of the items, then you can take back the deposit. It's normal, isn't it? So let's say he gives the 1,000 to the hotel. Then the hotel says, hey, Mr. Abu has been pestering for the money, I better pay him, he needs the money, right? So the hotel pays the 1,000 to Abu. Abu immediately pays the 1,000 to, Ali pays the 1,000 to Inchi Abu. Then Abu pays the 1,000 to Mr. Chong. Mr. Chong pays the 1,000 school fees. Then the school pays back the hotel for using the facilities. Then the 1,000 comes back to the hotel. Then when this guy finishes this thing, the 1,000 is paid back to him. So what happened? This guy, he brought 1,000 as a deposit for a short while, and all the debts have been cancelled and cleared. So no more appearing. And then the 1,000 also, he takes back and he gives the hotel. What it shows, this is the technique of netting. You see, this is what the essence of netting. Alright? So netting does that. It will cancel off all the debtors and creditors while a lot of transactions can take place in the economy. This is how the netting works. Huh? So now, if I put it in a matrix like this, the school gave to Mr. Chong, sold to the minister. Mr. Chong owes the school 1,000. The school owes the hotel 1,000. So if you put all this in one matrix, so the total credit is 1,000, the total debit is 1,000 for everyone. So if you see the netting, the credit minus the debit, the credit minus the debit, the credit minus debit, you see the netting, you find all the zeros. So anyone operating a payment system like this, then you do a netting periodically, let's say monthly or weekly or whatever, you find that all this can cancel. People can do a lot of transactions, but no money is needed. What happened? Right? So no money is needed. Do you get it? So all the debtors and creditors cancel out. But in real life, we cannot assume that things will cancel out exactly like this, isn't it? Right? So let's put a more realistic things. So some transactions here taking place. A number of transactions between them taking place. Let's say this is a community. This is a community in one place. So a lot of transactions can take place among them. So the system captures all the transactions, let's say like a monthly basis. So after a month, then you look at what is the total credit, what is the total debit, then you net out 2,000 minus this, this minus this, this minus this, this minus this, like that. So when you do that, at the end, you find the total negative and total positive will be the same. 1,600. That means the hotel has a credit of 1,000 extra, whereas the school owes 1,300 to the system. So at the end of the period, the school must pay 1,300, Inche Ali must pay 300, so total 1,600. So the 1,600 will be used to pay 1,000 to the hotel and 600 to Mr. Chong. Yes, so total will become zero. But what is the essence of the whole thing? If you notice, the essence is just by using 1600, only 1600, you are able to solve. Just with 1600, you are able to solve 10,900 worth of economic activities. Do you notice that? The total transaction that took place in the economy is 10,900. But the amount of money needed to settle that is only 1,600. You get it? So this is the essence of netting. Right? So when you do this, here I am putting it can be, so even if you do all this in ringgit, for example, there's already benefit. Netting gives a lot of benefit even if you do it in fiat money. But later I'll show you what would be the additional benefit if you do it gold based. So one more to show you another example, how government should do. Look at it, the netting system, right? Now let's say you're in a recession. In a recession, government must liquidity. There's a liquidity problem, isn't it? So governments can print money or do reduce the reserve requirement or whatever. So when is the recession? Government collects less tax because businesses are all sluggish, isn't it? Government collects less tax, a lot of unemployed people. You see, the streets are all very rubbish, uncollected. Why the streets are uncollected? Because government got no money to pay to people to collect the rubbish. So you see rubbish is dirty, you see the business luggage, you see a lot of people just loitering around the internet. I saw exactly something like this when I once visited Cairo. You know. At night I was visiting, I saw the streets all, you know, not properly kept, that those are all youngsters, you know, when you walk, they always tend to come close to you, and you move away, you know. Right? Sure and not, man. So, situations like this happen. Sorry to say, so, but how do governments try to solve the problem? They increase the liquidity. The government can first, they can borrow money with interest from financial institutions, like what we do, borrow from IMF, borrow from government, and then use the money to employ the guy. The guy who was unemployed now can stand up and start cleaning the street. When he cleans the street becomes, cleaner, the street is clean. And then he got money, he can pay, buy things from the supermarket. The supermarket is happy because they're making profit. Now they will happily pay their tax. When the owner of the supermarket comes up, he sees all the streets are clean, he's also happy. Right? So you jumpstart the economy, but then here it is by through borrowing money. You borrow money from the financial institutions, or you borrow money from the capital market, the open market area, operation by the government, where they issue the government bonds. Or it can also print money like quantitative easing. So they got extra money, and then with the extra money this thing. But if they borrow money without interest, what will happen? Then they will have to pay the interest, isn't it? So how do the government will pay the interest? They have to charge it to the people. So your GST will go up, huh? Your tax will go up, the GST will go up, because ultimately it's not the government, it's the people who have to pay, right? So when you borrow money from interest, if the government borrows money to jumpstart the economy, then ultimately the people will still got to pay for the interest, and we know the interest does not exist in the real form. Alright? So how are we suggesting we do it? What we are saying is the government need not borrow from financial institutions. You just employ this guy. In the netting system, you just employ this guy. You stand up, start cleaning the street. Alright? He starts cleaning the street, the system gives him a credit and a debit to the government. Because the netting system is an accounting system only. He just takes debit, credit only. So once he employs this guy, a credit is given to him, the government gets a debit. With the credit, now he can spend his money in the supermarket. With the credit. Now the supermarket is also happy. Alright, the supermarket is also happy. Sorry, it's not working at it. So the supermarket is also happy because it's making profit. So with the profit, they can pay tax to the government. So the tax will now cancel out the original debit created when the government started the process. So debit, credit, then all the credit is removed in the economy as money. And once it comes back to the source that created it, it will net it off. Get it now? So in other words, what a netting system does is that it monetizes goods and services. Right? It monetizes goods and services. So, no government should tell, we have no money. You have no money because you didn't bring the money. You bring the money, you can solve the problem. But the problem is, if you bring money, it will create inflation in the system. Because you bring virtual money and you do not create real things. But here, the money is quote unquote is created only when a good or service is created. Notice that a transaction is recorded only when a good or service is transferred. Isn't it? So only because of the goods or service is transferred, then only a transaction is recorded. Therefore, this system is non-inflationary. It won't create inflation like the present system, where you create a print money first before a goods or service is created. Get it? Okay, so I don't know whether this works or not. It's also not working. Eh? So next slide. So let me quickly go. I'll do another within 5 minutes so that we can have Q&A. Yeah? So let me go with the four characteristics that I mentioned. Eh? So it's a netting, then there is a gold base, it's interest-free, and it's electronic. What are the benefits if you do that? So let me go to the first one, why netting? There will be no shortage of money. That means there will be no real liquidity problem. It's exactly like our credit card system today, but only that our credit card system only records your expenditure only. It doesn't record your income. Because the credit card, because these credit card operators, they don't want to record your income. Why? So they will always record it. It's actually they're giving the money to you. So if you if you end of the month, if you delay the payment or this thing, they can charge interest on it. In reality, they don't even pay anything actually. They're just recording just like that. But this system will also record your income so that netting can take place. It's a net difference, right? So there will be no shortage of money. But with the way it will be given, just like the credit card, if you can bring 10,000 worth of goods and services into the economy, then the system will give you a 10,000 worth of credit. If you are a medical doctor, you can give services like 30,000 worth of services per month, then the system will give you 30,000 worth of credit for you to spend. It's based on what you can bring into the economy. Yeah? Like what the present system was for, right? So it basically is an accounting system that increases liquidity because of that. So in the present system, only the banking system is given the right to create money. Here, it actually gives the right to quote unquote, it gives you the right to create money to every individual. You see that? It provides abundant liquidity cheaply, as though the right to create money is vested in the hands of everyone and not just the bank, okay? And the increased liquidity promotes trade, it increases business, employment, profits, and taxes. You have to remember, in economics, if you go deep, when profits increase, the economic well-being, the standard of living goes up. That's why some people say, we should not take high profits and things like that, technically it's not correct. The more profit that is made by the economy is better. Because every profit is it reflects the amount of utility increase in the economy, as I mentioned to you just now. Right? So you must encourage as much profit as possible in the economy. It increases the standard of living of people. So the next next slide. Netting is also like producing amalgamated accounts of all parties. So like when you do amalgamated accounts, when you consolidate accounts, right? So it's like a consolidated accounts of all parties where debtors and creditors cancel out. So when you do this kind of system, netting system, and then when you prepare the annual balance sheets, a lot of debtors and creditors in the balance sheet will disappear. And netting monetizes real assets, goods and services, hence in a way redefines money. So if you understand money in detail way like this, you realize no government should come and say, hey, we have no money. You realize the moment you have people, who are skilled, you have resources in your land. So that is really money. That is money. It's not the pieces of paper we create as money. It's not the accounting. It is the ability to create goods and services. That is money. So no nation should. That's why I want to understand. No government should actually borrow money. Individuals can borrow money. I now is this thing. Let's say I fall sick. If I fall sick, yes, I may need help from my brothers. I'll say, can I borrow money? But if a nation asks for a loan, it means the entire nation is sick. Get it not? Well, can it happen or not? Yes, let's say a calamity like Haiti, something comes and destroys the entire nation, like a flood, like a hurricane or something. Then the nation needs help from outside country. Then we can say, yes, the nation needs to borrow at that point. But if you don't have any calamity, we're all okay, we're all healthy people, some healthy people, a lot of, some sick people, is normal. At that point, if a nation goes and borrow money from IMF, World Bank, please do not borrow money, then you don't understand what money is all about. A nation should never borrow money at interest. Get it? So it monetizes, realizes. In netting, there's no transfer of debt, if you notice. It just records the transaction, debit credit, accumulates, then net it off. After netting it off, then only a monetary transfer takes place at the end. So there's no transfer of debt. Therefore, Islamic finance, one need not resort to all kind of hela and tawarruk and commodity borabar and all funny things for financing working capital. So you can actually finance the working capital by doing this. Very cheap, very fast. Because a lot of SMEs, they face problem to finance working capital. Alright, next slide. So now why gold base? So even without gold base, the benefits are already there. The netting benefits are already there, even if it's without gold base. So why gold base? Why we still go away? I tell you why gold base. A lot of people, even our scholars, they cannot understand actually why our Sharia principles of Muamala, Zakat, Hudud, Mahar, all these, why they were based on gold as the standard. There's a hikmah. First of all, it provides a stable measure of value. When we do a lot of transactions among ourselves, right, then we need to measure the things that we are exchanging ourselves. If you put it as a ringgit, okay, I'm measuring this quote is a 10 under ringgit, then I ask you, what is a ringgit? Nobody can tell you what is a ringgit. It's just in a piece of paper, it's just one ringgit. The ringgit at a certain distinction before, now nobody can define it because it's virtual. Right? It has to be something. If you want to have a standard of measure, just like if I say a gram today and a gram in America, they are always same. If I say it's a meter in America, meter in China, same. Meter yesterday, meter today is the same, so that you can play a measure or a standard to measure things. So if money is measuring value, then we exchange. Why yesterday the exchange rate is through 2 point something, today is 4 point something, tomorrow is. It's like hey, yesterday my height was 3 feet, now today is only 2 feet. Tomorrow I don't know what will be my height. Right? It's actually stupid if you think like that. So in Islamic this thing, money is the standard. If I say my dinar, if I want to measure gold dinar, it is 4.25 grams of gold, the dinar in the times of the Prophet in today is the same. If this is the dinar here and dinar in China, it's the same. So I value everything is real. It has to be something real across time and space if you want to measure of value. And therefore, there's no monopoly like international currency. Because paper money is, it gives you a lot of benefit for the first time whoever is going to use it. So America now, others are enjoying. But not only America, every fiat money has that benefit. That's why if you go to our Islamic country, you say, no, we must go to gold, this is the real thing. They say, why? You know, this is, you're taking us back 4,400 years. I mean 1,400 years. Why? Because they can nicely sit and create money out of nothing. There's a lot of self-interest at play. Even when you say this, you said, so even the Islamic bankers would not agree if you say you go back to gold, because they're taking away the power to create money from that. Right? So there is no unfair similarity. The similarity is that same thing, the creating money out of nothing. So it is the most important thing when one is gold-based, it becomes non-inflationary because people cannot create money out of nothing. So that's why it is true. If you say the people, when they say a dinar 4.25 grams of gold during the time of the Prophet can buy you a sheep. Today also you can buy your sheep. A lot of times the proponents of gold will give you this example. It is true. If you have a dinar today, it's about 800 to 900 ringgit. Can you buy a gold for 900 ringgit? Yes, you can buy it with this thing during the time of the Prophet. You can also buy it here. I was giving this talk in Kazakhstan, this thing. I was mentioning this example. Then the person asked, okay, how much is the value of the dinar in the currency of Kazakhstan? They call it tenge. So they calculate, convert to this thing, and calculate. I was mentioning a certain amount, it's so much. Then the one guy from the audience says, yes, that's the price of a goat here. So it is standard. It will be inflation free the moment you price it. Next slide, please. So why are gold based again? So the moment you go gold based, it becomes a fixed exchange regime. So like what you're facing today, our thinking is nose diving, you will not face this kind of things at all. We must not face it because we are, we, you have skill, different skill, I have a different skill. We will exchange things, you know. But in between exchange, there's something that's distorting the exchange ratio. Because it is not real. So the moment you fix the price in gold, it becomes a fixed exchange regime. You know that. So once it becomes a fixed exchange regime, speculators in the currency market will disappear, arbitrages in the currency market will disappear, and you do not need the forward market, futures market, options market in the currency market. So, like Tim Marlin used to say, a chili market makes sense, but a currency market does not actually make sense. You go to market, you're chili, not people that demand. Right? What is the currency market? It is just manipulation. Someone is manipulating and stealing our resources. That's why I wrote my first book, is The Theft of Nations. So now when the ringgit is going down, someone is actually enjoying it, usually. At the expense of all our money and all we produce. Someone is just taking away our wealth. Periodically, they say, just come back, oh, currency going down. They say, you know? Sometimes I wonder, how do you, if you are working in a central bank, how do you want to justify yourself for your existence? How do you justify the existence of a central bank? Look at what has happened to the value of the ringgit. No, you know, you're supposed to gather the inflationary. Inflation is going up, the ceiling is again. You look at the exchange rate. Exchange rate, how do you justify yourself? What is the purpose of your existence? Right? Look at the people, how they are. So this is the problem. You know, once you go gold-based, it becomes stable. It protects the wealth of the people. And one of protecting the wealth of the people is one of the maqasid of Sharia. See? So you can see why the transactions of the Sharia principles are based on gold. It makes you protect the wealth that you produce. When the wealth becomes sovereignty. You see, if you lose your wealth then or later, you also lose the sovereignty of your nation. You will give away. Ultimately, you will find all the buildings, leasing, everything, all owned by foreigners. This is what will happen. And we give all this easily away by simply when they pay fiat money all or nothing. Next slide, please. I don't spend this one. You all know from your monetary thing. What is the criteria of good money? It is acceptable. It must be divisible. It must be homogeneous. It must be durable. These things so that it solves the barter problem. It's mobile, so it must be easily movable. It must be rare, so that it has a value on its own and a stable value, right? So when anything fulfills this criteria, it can play the role of money. So Islamically we use gold and silver, right? I mean, but also if you see the hadith of the Prophet of the date for date, silver for silver, you know, gold for gold, silver for silver, date for date, barley for barley, you know, all those six items the Prophet mentioned, they all fulfill the criteria for money. So by analogy, I can also say rice can play the role of money. By analogy, when you see the listing, right? So there's one of my students, he's from Palestine. Next slide, please. He's using, for example, olive oil in Palestine. Because in Palestine, they produce a lot of olive oil. People work there. If you see the criteria, olive oil also can play the role of money. So if you don't have gold, you don't have to be sad. After all, you don't need, even if you're in the netting system, you don't need a lot of gold. We just price things in gold. That's the only thing we need. Just price things. So if you don't want, you want to settle, you want this olive oil, also can. Right? So this is an interesting book if you're all interested in the concept of riba understanding through how our classical scholars derived our this thing by Professor Isana Nyazi from, he's a scholar. He said the truth is that if the strict legal position of Islamic law is adopted, all transactions in paper currency will become invalid. So you can get this book. It will nicely derive how you actually determine what is riba according to classical. It's a very interesting book. I would strongly recommend if you're a student in finance because you want to understand what is riba is. I would recommend you to get this book. Yeah, then it will show you how the classical scholars derive the riba. Okay, next. I have mentioned to you already how olive oil can play the role of money. Next. Now why non-interest based? Non-interest based is quite well known. I've done so many times, but let me quickly, already time. Should I go through this? No need, Okay, non-interest based. It does not cause an exponential growth in money and debt. Today, if you look at any country, if you look at the growth of money in the economy, and also growth of debt in the economy, you will notice it's an exponential growth. So the exponential growth comes from the compound interest formula. Right? So the money in the economy grows much faster than the real economy. It causes the inflation and it's destabilizing and it's unsettled because of the nature of interest itself. It does not, once it's non-interest based, it does not control wealth unjustly. In the present system, the interest base, it simply transfers the wealth from the bottom people to the top people simply by the structure of the monetary system. So the wealthy people need not actually do work. Automatically, a lot of work they are done by the people at the lower rung of the economy is transferred to them. This has been done, a lot of studies in the West, you can check that out. Does not contribute towards the widening gap of income and wealth distribution. You can see the wealth distribution gap becoming wider and wider. When it's non-interest, it's not cost that. And it promotes cooperation in economy rather than competition. When it's interest-based, you will find a lot of people talk about competition. It's just competition. You must beat that guy. You must beat this business. It's all competition. But the moment you remove, and when you realize it is our life is actually a life of exchange, I will give you something good for you, you give me something good for me. That's how we enjoy economic life. It becomes a life of cooperation. You see? So when you remove interest, you get life of cooperation. In an interest-based system, it's all about competition, you know. We must be the right. So that's how it, so it promotes stability and sustainability of the economy and the environment. This is the most important thing now everyone is talking about. Yeah? I will also draw you to the book I mentioned a few times, by a book by Professor Bernard Leiter, that they have linked that the last missing link to sustainability. If you want to reach sustainability, the missing link is actually the money. Here it is done at the University of Berkeley. Finally, the monetary system is the one last missing link to achieve sustainability by Professor Bernard Leiter and his group. So you can see that promotes stability and sustainability in the economy and the environment. Otherwise, the earth is gone, continue to do like this. Then the last one, please. Because I don't get a chance to all the time go through this. Last time, when I talk about problem, before I reshare the text already. Last slide. Okay, why electronic? Right? The last characteristic. First, it is cheap, it's fast, it's efficient payment system globally. So when we talk about going back to gold days, we're not asking people to carry gold in gold coins in your pocket. Yeah, right? We have to use modern fintech, use modern electronic payment systems. So IGENS is a modern electronic payment system, right? Electronic money and e-wallet is the way to go, and is the system I mentioned is compatible with contemporary fintech trends, right? And promotes financial inclusion, cheap and efficiently. Whether you are poor, whether you are rich, everybody will now be given a chance to create, quote-unquote, your own money. You have ability to produce goods and services, the system will allow you to create money. Therefore, you will never face the shortage of money in the system. So financial inclusion, cheap and efficiently, and it can be easily modified to attain a wide variety of socio-economic objectives, actually. This one, I need more to explain it. But next slide, please. So some of the netting systems that are already existing, simple netting is already existing globally. The mutual credit clearance system that existing in a number of countries is also a netting system. The World Bank in Switzerland that gives out billions of dollars of financing interest-free in Switzerland. Imagine there's a bank in Switzerland that can give billions of dollars of financing interest-free. World Bank is also a netting system. The commercial credit circuit that's being done in South America, American countries like Uruguay and Brazil is a very interesting netting system where it gives you, finances, companies, working capital financing almost free. It's also a netting system. The local exchange trading schemes are what's called NETs, commercial barter exchanges, a netting system, and the bilateral payment arrangements and multilateral payment arrangements by central banks are also netting systems. So when the bankers realize the netting system is very powerful, so if you go to our Payments Act, Malaysian Payment System Act, you know this thing. If you want to do netting, they say you must also get permission from the bank in order to do this. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa
barakatuh. And please, once you ask the question, if you could turn on your mic so all of us can hear what you have to say.
Name.
Yeah. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much. It's a very informative presentation. How can we guarantee e-currency. E-currency, yeah. So, but the current paper currency we have, It was based on gold. Now, by whether or not it evolved, exploded, and it's all over based on God.
Yeah.
How can we guarantee that the digital system that you are suggesting will not evolve to electronic currency in the future?
So just like brothers, if you notice that, if you clearly notice the system, it's actually an accounting system only. It's not even a payment system. It is actually just accounting. It's even it just records the debit credit. Only at the end of the period when the settlement is done, then a transfer takes place, right? So it is actually an accounting system of the transactions. But the other thing is, whoever is going to operate this, you know, especially when you if it's gold based, then the last transfer must be gold, isn't it? So that one, you know, the operator must you must have custodians and trustees and things like that to operate it, right? And then one good thing about this is that it does not force people. You know, like see, for example, now I talk to you about this. Some of you will agree, some of you cannot agree to this, right? So when you this is only for people who agree, isn't it? Let's say some 10 of us agree. So we can implement a payment system within the 10 that agrees. So the system does not force others to not want. So we can implement it with cooperatives, we can implement it with let's say a chamber of commerce. Right? Or we can even implement it with the community that agrees. So that's the interesting part of FinTech, the electronic payment system. You can create a payment system within payment system. Right? Yes. But that's why I was telling you just now, it is just for people who agree that this is a system. Then we implement it. We should not force other people. I don't believe in forcing people. No, I don't believe in forcing people. We can have all debates this thing. If you don't this thing, we can always agree with disagree. And then we'll make our decision together. Right? So we will not force this thing. So it's not 100% movement. But if you think that the gold price is being manipulated, yes. But you notice the success of the entire thing I mentioned here is actually lies in what you know. Can anyone tell me? The success of this entire thing, if you really want to achieve this, lies in pricing things in gold. Not even having the gold. I have to tell this computer is in how much in gold equivalent, maybe 2 dinar or this thing. This mic is maybe in how much in equivalent of silver. It's in pricing. So the moment if you still price in let's say ringgit and then you settle in gold, then there will be a pricing risk. Today you want to implement this, not only a gold price risk will be there, there will be an exchange rate also risk there. Two risks will be involved. You know, if you are doing the thing, isn't it? So no. So you want to really implement this in success, it all lies in pricing it in gold. The moment you price that in gold, then the fiat money will take a backseat. You get it? You price in ringgit and settle in gold, you have two risks involved. So the quantity of gold and things like that's not a real issue. Huh? You actually, if you really realize, you can actually transact net off a lot of things, and then you only settle at the end of the period. But then in actual implementation, you can actually continue to make the system continue forever. That means actual settlement may not be actually necessary. In other words, actual gold settlement may not be actually necessary. So what will be necessary? You will be actually exchanging goods and services that we take benefit from. Right? That's why economic well-being, the number one thing that we have to do is what? It's actually education. education is the number one thing that you have to. You want to do any economic development you want to talk about, monetary system is number two. You must create people who can create goods and services. So good and services can come only when you educate people. So you have to make 100% people, everybody born in the country, make sure the person is educated. That the person can produce something good and services for the economy. So if I were a minister of this thing, I would spend about 20% of the GDP of a country maybe for education and R&D. You will find that with one generation you will see what is coming. Yes, sir.
I have a question regarding the education system, how the process. I know the assumption is the debtor will pay back the creditor. But what happened if, for example, was
default
or maybe like debt, something like this?
Yeah. So, you see, if someone in the system, and then let's say a default take place or debt take place, it's actually it's just like a normal credit card system. What happens if someone dies while in the credit system? Right? Either the system, either the people, other people, they are descendants of, you can pay and pay off if you want to. Otherwise, the system will just continue. Any credit and things like that, they all become transferable and so on, just like inheritable. You can also let other people settle it and so on. So, in a complete system, an Islamic system, if you have it, let's say someone defaulted, can't pay already, right? So, he's a debtor. So, once he's a debtor, the system will stop him from continuing to spend and so on, right? So, the other people you can settle, or you become automatically a recipient of zakat, because zakat people, you're listening, or wakaf, something. The system will come and settle the thing. It's just like a normal present system, how we deal with that.
My question is, what's the physical form of this
system?
Physical form? Yeah. Is it paper? So why not say we return
that to the gold-based? What do you mean? Physical means how it is implemented?
The gold-based.
The gold-based banking system is basically an electronic payment system. It will use your mobile phone, digital, it will use your electronic transfer, right? And also the point of sales, the POS that you go to the supermarket, it is connected like that. Alright? But the settlement of the gold, it will be done through a bank or operator that has a gold vault. Right? In fact, in my company, we already have the system done with your company. So now it's just to go.
Why not?
Why not? Now everyone is going, cashless digital. There's one that you read that just a few days ago. A village in India is now gone cashless in India. This is village people, farmers, they're all going cashless. All using mobile phone systems. In Kenya, have you heard about M-Pesa? And Visa uses mobile credit, your credit and transferring that as money. And Visa is, for example, let's say you have your mobile credit, right? I want to send 1,000 ringgit to my mother. I just click $1,000 transfers to my mother already, and my mother can go and either spend it or you can go and convert it back, the dealers, those who are selling cars. You go to them and they will pay. Okay, so it's time's up. So thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.